Octavius Yokosuka, Captain Dave Glenister, Master Chief Marty King, here to, after a brief holiday break, several weeks holiday break, back to take your ICE comments and give you some news of things that's going on out there. Things that's going on.
That's not even proper grammar, I don't think. But give you some news and push for some general things. So a couple things coming up, things to consider here. Down the road, I think in March, we're going to do the road tax road show. Like we did last year, this is where you have to go and you have to pay your road tax. Then you have to go to VRO, and then you get your decal and put your decal on your car. And I say that, and it may sound like very Yogi Bear Boo Boo, but any one of those out of sequence, out of order, or not done by June 1st leads to your car being impounded. So even things, oh, I have the sticker here, I just didn't put it on, you can't do that. So we are going to change a few things up a little bit, make it a little bit easier for you, get some more terminals down there. Once you pay your road tax at the Fleet Theater, you can go back to VRO, you can go to pay, you know, stay right there in line. We'll also have some terminals open in security itself. I'm going to expand that. If you have no idea what I'm talking about because you're brand new here, that's why I want to start advertising this now. But we are going to do it again at the Fleet Theater. So just something to tuck away, March, April time frame. Seems far down the road, but it'll be here before you know it.
Might be a good idea for some folks to dust off the papers in their glove box and make sure their JCI and other insurances and inspections are up to date.
You will be shaken down for your JCI. Even I am shaken down for my JCI when I was parked illegally, but you know, they come by, they check on you, and hey, can I, you know, license and registration, what did you get in the States? Here, we ask for your JCI. And in this case, they ran the numbers. Database wasn't up to date, but I did have the paper in the car. Sometimes that happens. We got about 7,000 registered Y-plate cars here. So even an error rate of 1% is, what, 70 cars? Don't do math in public, but it's a large number. And so it's possible that, you know, the database doesn't have it in there. Always have your paperwork together when you're out and about and on the base. So, yes, make sure that's up to date, make sure that's renewed, and you will be good to go. The other thing I want to start pushing for, or we have pushed for it, so visitors. A lot of folks have visitors come on a routine basis. It doesn't have to be the same person, but, you know, some folks, you have friends out in town that you've met, whether it be a personal, you know, relationship friend, or just, you know, couples that you've met, and you bring them on base. So it's easy to sign them in, get a one-day paper pass. If you're going to have someone come on board, one of your friends, come on board more than a couple times a year, we have this pass that is a small card, and it's laminated, and it has their name on it, and it has your name on it. And now you can just show that pass with your ID and walk right in. There is no more signing required. So it's like a permanent daily pass.
It's like the speed pass at Disneyland.
It is. It is. It's like it's basically you're pre-vetted, okay? It's like a small laminated card with the picture and height and weight and all other stuff on there. But it is something to inquire about. If you have someone who's going to come all the time, instead of waiting, and maybe it takes a little longer, I think 15 minutes or so to get these things, but that's the last time you have to do it for like a year, okay? So if you're going to have someone you're going to sign in routinely, just get one of these things. Invest that time a little bit, and it's so much easier. So much easier. So I'm pushing this for a couple reasons. One is it's kind of a newer type of thing. A lot of folks don't know what's out there. But also, I mean, and for very selfish reasons, the more of these we have, that is less time people will spend at the Industrial Security Office to sign people in. So I'm trying to make it easier on my folks, too, as well as easy on you. So if you have someone who's going to come several times a year, I'd say if you're going to come more than three times in the next year, just get one of these passes. Much easier.
Absolutely. Yeah.
All right. With that, we'll head into our it's been quite a while, so some of these are older. We'll skip some of the ones that are kind of OBE, overcome by events, and move on here. So here's a kind of a strange one. It hasn't been followed up yet, but I did want to throw this one out here. I'm not sure quite where to go with it, but I throw it there to see if you have some of these problems, to let you know the places to go to deal into it. So on October 18th, 14, so you can tell this is back from December, I was married in the Philippines. Returned from leave, updated the page two, and upon receiving my marriage cert, when they got that in November, I was not informed of losing my OHA and found out while viewing my November end of the month LES, the OHA had been canceled and a debt for the OHA received, you know, kind of the prorated stuff, had happened. So basically because they couldn't get dependent location, because their new spouse lived back with their parents or something like that. What do I do? Well, I say this as a general comment. Every situation is different and unique. This happens to be not too far one-off, but you think about it. Okay, you just got married, so now you have a dependent. You have to ask for dependent location, but the dependent doesn't have a lease because they're not paying a lease. They're living with their parents. So these kind of things, best to work those out ahead of time and ask a lot of those questions.
Yes.
So you cannot have – here's the kind of the difference if you were in CONUS. If you're in CONUS, you can have BAH for where you live or your dependent location. You obviously can't get both, right? That's double dipping. Here it's a little different in that we can't give you a house if you're in family housing unless your family is with you. So it's not just that you get one or the other. They actually have to be here for you to get this right. Kind of entitlement. I think this is where this has fallen, right?
From the OHA.
I don't think you're entitled unless you actually have your family here. But I don't want to speak out of turn for the personnel support detachment, PSD. So my plug is, if you're going to change your status, get married, move your family out here, or your family's going to go ahead and move back to CONUS, you got to work that ahead of time because all these situations are somewhat unique.
Yep. Which is why you end up in a payback situation because you were drawing an allowance that you were no longer entitled to, and they will take that back.
They will. Now, even after the fact, and here's many of us know this, but I'm going to tell you now. So if you have to, if money has to come out of your check, they try to take it out in one check. I have known people who have $0 and 0 cents in a paycheck because they take it all at once. Right. So unless you make arrangements otherwise. That's why it's important to look this stuff up ahead of time. And also, obviously, if you come here ahead of your family, and you move into Navy housing because they're going to come out in the next month or something like that. And there's certain times we allow folks to do that because there's a certain amount of days that you're authorized and there's certain more days I can waive. If you do that, your BAH is going to stop because the government's already paying for you to get one house or one location, and that's that. So, and then you end up this payback situation. So just plan for that. Make arrangements for that. Okay, let's see. Ice comment is in relation to the recent upsurge in bicycle riders becoming more and more aggressive and not following the base safety policy concerning bicycle and pedestrian safety. All I'm going to say is yes, and we actually do. I track every day. I get a list of the number of bicycles we've impounded, people we've issued citations to, and all this.
We had 47 bicycles impounded yesterday.
Was that high?
It was on this morning's.
47 impounded. But if you think about it, that seems like a large number. But there are thousands of bicycles on this base.
Yes.
So of the 7,000 MLCs, that's the master labor contractors, the Japanese nationals that work here, only about half have a vehicle pass to drive on every day. The rest, a lot of them, either ride bicycles here or ride them once they are here, especially the ship repair facility, SRF, has a lot of those. So there are a lot out there. And so I just encourage you, one, I encourage you to follow the rules, two, encourage you who have that ability to enforce those rules on people. And we will keep doing that as well. We have had some surges where we just grab a whole bunch of bicycles at once and make people come and sign a I'm a bad person statement and I won't do it again to get their bicycles back. But it is dangerous. You see people zipping across. I'm surprised
yes.
We have more accidents here. And we try and do our part. And people will, you know, some of the ice come and say, hey, we have to light this thing up with these crosswalks. I almost hit somebody. Yes. But it is your responsibility to watch out for pedestrians and bicyclists, but a large majority of keeping yourself safe is just that, keeping yourself safe. You know, look both ways before you cross the road. Yes. I was in Alexandria, Egypt, years ago, the second highest rate of pedestrian fatalities. First is Cairo. One of the reasons is that there's no way to cross the roads there. There's a story behind that one. But the other one is, if you are hit as a pedestrian in the road, nothing happens to the driver because you're not supposed to be there. So they don't slow down. It's kind of their own, you can say what you want. But, so all the burden is placed on you. So take a little bit of personal responsibility. Acknowledge why we have these rules. Do not zip across the road, especially when it's wet here. Everything, the roads are all shiny, right? A lot of reflection. So evening time, very dangerous on base. Tough to see the crosswalks. Everything looks the same. Everything's lit the same. And so please be careful out there. And please follow the rules. Akego, Club Takamiya, All Hands Club. I got the shrimp taco special tonight. It was very delicious. Red onions really brought the flavors. Really enjoyed the tortilla soup as well. Love how the restaurant is kid-friendly. with the high chairs and have a top to put food on, and the kids' plates, silverware, et cetera. Says, I have two little children. It's nice to have a restaurant that thinks about kids, too. So I bring this one out. Club Takamiya, for those of you who don't know, is out there in Ikego.
Yes.
You should go there. Sometimes they get beat up, but that's why I wanted to kind of pass on some good news here. And they are trying to do new things, trying to do some specials here to bring things up. But the more you go, the more flexibility they will have and the more specials they can try and the things spin up there. This one's for Chili's. Want to mention Miss Satsuki Sato has always been giving outstanding service and always super polite. You know where Chili's is over by the Navy Lodge? Those of you who've been in the Navy Lodge know it all too well. That's the closest thing that you have there. So
it's a very busy restaurant.
It is a very busy restaurant. Yeah. So they're doing good things over there. We are trying to work some breakfast options around the base.
Yes.
Actually, there's a comment in here about breakfast options. I just want to read that about Chili's. I think they offer it on weekends, but not
Saturday and Sunday.
But not during the
week.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So we're going to try and, not that I can't really force Chili's to do anything, but we're going to try and look at some breakfast options, and we'll mention that later on. AmeriCable. I just have to read this because I think it's a running streak that I have America. Come on! All caps, 3 exclamation points. Come on! You just replaced equipment, and I continue to get disconnected 20, 30 times a day. So, yeah. That's, you know, AmeriCable, as you know, I don't control. If I could control it, I would change it, probably, or at least offer competition. And we are working on that. So, Boingo, for those of you who know what Boingo is, wireless and some other options to bring, particularly the internet access side of things to Yokosuka. Those options are being worked by Naval Region Japan. And I'm very appreciative, not just for Yokosuka, but for all over Japan, and trying to find some kind of competition or allowable alternatives for wireless in particular. Because, you know, when AmeriCable went in, wireless was not envisioned. In fact, streaming movies was not envisioned. And the deal they have in order to come in, they say, hey, we're going to replace all this infrastructure, cables and wires, is we want this long-term contract, which they have. The world has changed. Their ability to meet customer needs has changed, and they're in. So we're going to try and do some other things. But no, I can't fix AmeriCable. So sorry about that. Is there any way the Teen Center can inform the community of changes in the schedule? You know, Facebook. Is there an Ikego community page or email? So. Our goal in the child youth programs is to provide high-quality education and recreation programs for children, with our staff comprised of caring, knowledgeable professionals who plan developmentally appropriate programs. Yes, yes, yes. I'm just going to say yada, yada, yada. In response to your comments, we are currently working to better streamline our process due to a new position being created here in Ikego. And put a new person out there. We'll strive to notify the public via Facebook and when and if any future events are canceled. So, I have my own opinion on social media. Both it has pros and cons in a lot of ways. But for those official pages, which is what I encourage you to go to, it is a good way to push. And so in your own keeping yourself informed of stuff, there is push and there is pull. We try to push, you know, what we consider to be time-critical, you know, safety-relevant things. Changes to the tropical cyclone condition of readiness, gate closures, road things. We do that through CDNS. Which is kind of like, so if you want to sign up for email notifications of these big things, like the main gate will be closed Sunday afternoon because of a demonstration or things like that, you know, tropical cyclone condition of readiness one, stay indoors. Send your email, phone number if you want to. So email, phone number, and your PRD, so we know when to take you off of this thing, or you'll get them forever, to cfay-cdns@fe.navy.mil, which is fareast.navy.mil. So CFA-CDNS, and send email, phone, PRD. You'll get in there, and you'll get, we don't send things very often. This is the nicest, beautiful day. Right now it is the 23rd of January. It's the most beautiful, icy snow day predicted that we have. But, hey, even if you told me, hey, there's a 60% chance that you'd actually get snow, because we also have Yokohama as well,
yes.
And there's higher elevations. They always ice and snow before we do. And it's not just about, it's a nice weekend, so people are going to be going out and about. So we will put out there, hey, there's an advisory somewhere else too. And sometimes it doesn't happen, but I would rather have you be aware there's a potential than say, oh, it's probably not going to happen. And it turns out we get, 8 inches of snow on a weekend that, drops the power off the base, which happened last year. Some of these things get predicted now. For the Officers Club, awesome Christmas dinner. Our entire family enjoyed it. Thank you, and Merry Christmas. And Merry Christmas, Happy New Year to you. Akimashite and Meitoto Gozaimasu to our Japanese viewers. Okay, so let's see here. Here is one from Fleet and Family. Fleet and Family Support Center does many, many things. Everything from behavioral health issues to helping you find a job to work on your resume and those types of things. So here, I went to Fleet and Family seeking information about building my resume. Vanita Murray helped me build an effective resume and also boosted my self-esteem, and I wasn't expecting that. She really enjoys her work. I'm forever grateful for all her help and support. So Vanita Murray, she also will fill in sometimes for the director when the director is on travel and going around to different things. So Vanita Murray does a great job. She was employee of the quarter.
Yes.
One of these quarters, too. So she does an outstanding job over there. So there are many things at Fleet and Family that you... Hey, I got to tell you, I only went to Fleet and Family when I was in CONUS, rarely. And that was like for one of my sailors. And that was to drag them over there to show them where the building was and said, hey, you need some financial management help or something. But here, it really does take on a much bigger role than it would be in CONUS. So I encourage you to, you know, it's right across from the commissary. So spend some time, go over there, walk around, and look at the information on the walls and see. Hey, there's stuff there. You're looking for employment, modeling fairs, help for any other kind of problems. The sexual assault prevention response team, people hang their hat there for those, the program manager side of things. All the, you know, a lot of volunteer organizations, you know, yes. The Yokosuka Enhanced Spousal Sponsorship, so if you ever want to become a sponsor, all those things are all over there, and they do a lot of good things. I think the SLO is over there now, isn't he, too, right? The school liaison?
Yes.
School liaison office. So if you're going to transfer out and go to a different school, like somewhere in the States, you're not sure if, if your grades transfer up or how to do that, the school liaison officer is there for you, too. It's not just for coming in. It's for going outbound as well. And they're all in one spot. So, yes, Fleet and Family Sports Center, plug, shout out for them. Here's one for the Keigo parking, and this is by the Mini Mart Club T, Club Takamiya, and the pool area. Dissatisfied with the parking lot. Lot was redone, but there's no spots were reserved for the Mini Mart or the club. So what's happening is people are parking there and going to Tokyo for the weekend. So Odie Smith is the safety czar here in Yokosuka. He answered this one personally. Like most of these are actually answered by the department heads themselves. So safety specialist was dispatched on the 9th of January. To survey the site. And he and I have actually spoken about that as well. And perhaps reserving that to some smaller time frame of parking, several hours of parking. And then
I think we were talking about a 4-hour.
4 hours is kind of a standard for a service type thing. That's what we do kind of over by our commissary here. And then the along the road that follows from the entry gate all the way down there, maybe making that, you know, 12-hour or something like that. So encouraging people, if they're going to go, because, you know, the Jimuji Gate is right there. For people to walk out to the train station, so I understand why you would want to park there, but we do need to kind of reserve that for some more customers. So we're looking at those things, and so safety's looking at that. So thank you for your comment. Mean Jeans, the Fleet Rec Center, thank you to the staff members for being so kind. I haven't been there in a long time. I mean, I am. I walk right past it as I go up to or down from the gym there. But Mean Jeans is one of those places that's open late, that food court, 24 hours over there.
Yep.
So good stuff there. And let's make this the last one before we take a break here, I think. How are we good? Last one, okay. So this is for MWR Yokosuka Entertainment. Thank you for continuing to bring a diverse variety of entertainers to Yokosuka and having some wonderful staff members. So this is passed on to Greg Hoover. He's the entertainment director to share with the staff for a job well done. And thank you very much.
Yes.
We have...
He's doing a great job. It's Greg Hooper, and I'll tell you what, it takes a lot of work in the background that a lot of folks don't see to get the different type bands, to get all the other entertainers. Could be a football player coming to visit.
Yeah.
Could be the Harlem Globetrotters.
Nelly?
Yes.
So hopefully you've all recovered from the Nelly concert by the time of airing of this thing. But and a lot of times these folks will come to Japan. And they will want to, you know, help out with the troops. They're maybe doing another concerts elsewhere, and we just have to pay for their travel and stuff. But it takes some doing to get some people in here, and that's what these people think about and work about all the time. So if you want some entertainment or you've got some good ideas for the kind of stuff, you may feel free to ice that as well, and we'll try and take that on board. But thank you very much for your comment. I think they're doing a great job too, and you know, trying to serve the whole community. So with that, we will take a short break and be right back.
The five Sullivan brothers were young men who grew up in Waterloo, Iowa. They joined the Navy after Pearl Harbor. They joined the Navy together on the agreement by the Navy that they would be able to serve on the same ship.
You know, that, I mean, their motto was that they stuck together. So looking at my dad and my uncles, I can understand why they wanted to be together, or any siblings would want to be together.
They joined the Juno, the USS Juno, a light cruiser, on Valentine's Day, 1942.
The way I understand it, they were in a group of ships off of Guadalcanal, and there was a Japanese submarine that fired a torpedo that was not actually meant for them. It was meant for the San Francisco, I think it was called. And it missed the San Francisco and hit the Juno, which is a light cruiser which they were aboard, and it hit right in the magazine where all the ammunition is, and the ship just exploded. And the only people that survived were the ones that happened to be on deck. The rest of them were just immediately gone.
And they were lost at sea in November 13th, 1942.
To me, they were heroes, and I just felt like they did it, I wanted to do it. I can't tell you why, but I felt that it was my calling to go into the Navy. My dad and my uncles were in the Navy, so I felt that I should go too. Of course, I wasn't a hero, but...
As far as Iowa, they were five young blue-collar guys who were fairly well known in the city. So Waterloo as a city took the loss, you know, very hard. I mean, everybody sort of knew one of the brothers, knew the folks. They lived in the north end of town by the railroad tracks, and so they were well known, and all of a sudden, these men are gone.
And it's not only my dad and my uncles. There were a lot of sailors in World War II that lost their life. Every one of them, you know, we should remember all of them. It makes me feel good about the Navy, about the military, and everybody that serves.
Well, here at the museum, we use the five Sullivans to represent the service and the sacrifice of all Iowa veterans from the Civil War to present. So in that sense, no other family has sacrificed as much, and we believe that's an important story to tell. I mean, that's 70 years ago that happened. And for the young people who come through our building, that loss is history to them. But, you know, every year we send out young men and women to serve in Iraq, Afghanistan, as well as other parts of the world. That sacrifice in terms of being gone and that sacrifice in terms of losing family members is still there. And so it's a reminder that whether it's one individual or whether it's five individuals, you know, we are still putting people in harm's way. And one, we need to support them, and two, when they are lost, we need to recognize their service.
Welcome back, Fleet Activities Yokosuka. Whether you are in the city of Zushi, Yokohama, parts unknown, watching this on YouTube, underway, or here in Yokosuka, Dave Glenister, Marty King, back to take your comments. And we're not reading all the comments on the air. Some are of a very specific nature, asked and answered. Some were our customer service type things where, you know, it's maybe a one-off or something and they have been dealt with. And others we are digging deeper, we forward on. Some are even of a kind of a legal nature. So you know, the ICE system is really meant for kind of, you know, comment, you know, customer service type things. But if something goes in there that we think, you know, belongs squarely in the realm of NCIS, you know, we take care of that and we move that on to those places where it has to go to be, you know, doing the right thing is doing the right thing. But those things we don't necessarily read on here. So, and if you don't put your contact information, you will never know. You might think you just forward this over here and nothing happens. Things happen, but sometimes we are not going to read some of those on here to call someone out, but we will take action.
And please leave your name and contact, because it's not public knowledge who you are when we're dealing with these, but we may actually have to come back to you and ask for more information. And some of these do require action.
Right, and sometimes, you know, we may need you to come in, especially some of these more, you know, hey, there's kids that are stealing things here. We may need you to come in and make a statement, because there's not much we can do without some kind of evidentiary piece of something to back it up.
Yes.
So it is good. And don't worry about it. I mean, unless you say, hey, I'm committing crimes and here's my contact information, we're not going to come after you. And no one else is going to know about it. Okay. So I think we have one for Akego, which has a new fitness center because we had to move the old one with the joint use area, which, by the way, the ceremony, 31st of January, 9 o'clock out of the Akego. I think it's like a fun run out there. So if you're seeing this on a Thursday night beforehand, please go out there. Should be a good time. We want to try and make this. This is the area that is where part of the campgrounds are, where the old entry gate is. There's going to be an opening ceremony on there on the 31st. But the new Akego Fitness Center is great. I love all the equipment. It would be nice to have small storage cubicles for small items like keys and jackets. I've been using the children's area benches. There seems to be some wall space by one of the entrances that would be perfect. So this is a very good suggestion. Problem, recommend solution. Sometimes we can't use your solutions for other reasons, but I always appreciate having one. Otherwise,
you're all rolling.
You know, the Navy's full of problem finders, and that's not what we need. Problem solvers is what's out there, and you are offering a solution. So we love being able to provide awesome fitness opportunities in Akego, and we have those storage cubicles you mentioned on order, and they should be here soon. So they're asked and answered. Your feedback, making life better out there in Akego. So thank you for that. This is for the Akego Youth / Teen Center, which they are getting a new building here. March?
I think it's next month. The CB's built it.
CB's built it. Yeah, CB's built it. So we're going to try and have some opening ceremony for that thing, too. It's kind of behind Club Takamiya.
Yes, sir.
Yes. You can laugh. That was funny. All right. Thank you, Mr. Eddie in Yokosuka, Mr. Chad in Akego, and Mr. Gordon in Yokosuka for always making my son feel special at the Akego Teen Youth Center there. Thank you for always allowing him to go to the Sea Paradise on 12:30 or the 30th of December. And it's one of the highlights of his winter break. So there you go.
Good. You know, Akego does a very good job for youth and teen, the center, and the sports out there. But, you know, remember, sometimes we get some negative comments about that.
We do.
And realize that a lot of that stuff is actually done because we have a great pool of volunteers. So... good on all those volunteers, but if you're one of the ones who's making a negative comment, maybe if you gave up some of your time as a volunteer, we wouldn't have a negative comment. This is a positive comment.
It's a positive comment, and I very much appreciate it. I think that the big difference between Akego and here, in terms of the volunteers for the coaches and things,
single sailors.
So there is a lot of single sailors. And we recognize them all the time in various means who volunteer at USO, Red Cross, Navy Marine Corps Relief, and those ones are kind of formalized. But they're also a lot of our coaches. Yep. And we even have like, a lot of the corpsmen will go on some of these outdoor rec hikes, adventures, even when they were the junior ROTC, were doing their drill team. Corpsmen were there volunteering their time in case someone got hurt. Sometimes, you know, they miscue on their spinning rifle and someone gets injured. And they do that all the time. Well, out in Akego, it is purely families. So we don't have as many, you know, single sailors that are volunteering, and obviously a lot of, you know, deployed sailors. Of the 9,200 sailors or so, about 2,000 are permanently ashore, and about the other ones are deployable of some fashion.
Absolutely.
Right? Not all on ships, but they're all deployable. So, yeah, there's a lot less folks out there. But you can volunteer and never leave the house. There's a lot of these organizations. You know, I had a friend of mine who was big into, you know, baseball back in Virginia. And when he started losing time to be a coach, he became like the assistant commissioner for the league.
Right.
So worrying about registrations and worrying about ordering the uniforms and these things he could do at night and do on his own because he didn't have that time or didn't have the regularly regimented time to be here at this time. But he could do that stuff. And there's a lot of stuff you can do. And there's a lot of folks who are doing it. Folks who are a single parent with three or four kids because their wife or husband's gone, and they are just doing this from home and doing it. So please step up and do it. Another one for Club Takamiya here. A lot of Akego ones this time. It's kind of interesting. First night of a new menu, it was quite busy, and we did have to wait for a table. Well, that's good. I mean, for Club Takamiya. But that was fine, and it's to be expected. Service was superb, as usual, and the food was yummy. Thank you so much for expanding the menu. And for being here for over a year, we need some new options. So, yeah, when you have more people coming and they're looking at doing a menu, that's where, you know, ever wonder why the specials come from in the restaurant business? The specials are how they test the waters. and see if people are going to like it. They offer the specials, they get feedback on how many people order the special again and again, and then it becomes a permanent item or gets dropped. Or they only bring it back occasionally because it may have unique ingredients or something. But the more people go, the more they can try specials, the more they can add to their menu. If they don't have a lot of people coming, they can't change the menu because they can only buy the stuff that is already on there. And so the more it gets used, the better it gets. So it sounds like, anecdotally, there's an uptick here in Club Tea. The Officers Club thoroughly enjoyed the chef's table presented by the O Club on New Year's Eve and look forward to more of those. Mr. Tolliver, Andre Tolliver, is doing a great job out there. And
new manager. A lot of good comments.
Yeah, the O Club is offline till mid-March.
Not all of the O Club.
Not all the O Club.
The restaurant is going to be offline until April.
Restaurant. So, yes, the bar area is, and you know, there's some eats that you can get in there as well.
Some finger foods.
Finger foods and things. But the clubs are offline, and they're kind of redoing a lot of things. Had to redo the ventilation, and so we are looking forward to that reopening, taking the opportunity to not just change the ventilation being the hood ventilation in the kitchen. And since it's one kitchen that supports all the different aspects, whether it be the warehouse, the dining room, the other rooms, that's why the whole thing is shut down. So we're taking the opportunity to upgrade and do some things, and looking forward to what Mr. Tolliver is going to come up with here in the next few months. Let's see. Fleet Fitness. You guys get Fleet Fitness. Renovations were needed. I think it's talking about the lockers, right? Yes. But now appears to be some mildew in the shower area. Recommendation would be to use bleach-based cleaner. Well, you know, actually, people have kind of backed away from that a little bit because the bleach, the fumes and stuff can be just as dangerous to humans and linger. So actually, a good soap solution with disinfectant is actually kind of more the wisdom now. Bleach is what we used to use, but people kind of backing away from that. But anyway, point taken. Clean it. I brought you concerns multiple times with the employees regarding the new digital lockers. To my knowledge, there's no plan in place for persons after hours whose lockers become inoperable while they're in the shower, resulting in a situation where some of the lockers have to be broken into by people trying to get their own clothing due to a dead battery or malfunctioning lockers. Yeah, actually, I don't use the lockers over there. I kind of jog over there and do my thing and then go home because I'm pretty close to Fleet Rec. I mean, it's probably half mile. So I just weave that in there. So I'm not even sure.
Bring a bag where you're working out at.
I've seen that too. That's why I'll like bring like my windbreaker and put it under the elliptical while I'm going. So I'll have to get over there and check this out on what exactly the concerns are with that and the proposed solutions we have here. But what was the answer put out there is we had the cleaning crew know to pay closer attention to the cleaning of the entire Fleet gym. And also we'll be bringing lockers to the locker room that people can use with their own lockers after hours. So these are these digital things which kind of go offline. And then if you're, you know, after hours, you may be maybe just out of luck. And so now we're gonna have regular lockers for after hours things, make it a little easier, conventional. I don't know. I don't think newer is always better. But
no, and they are going to bring back some lockers with to use the standard lock and key.
Because it's the right thing to do. Okay, here's an interesting, I'd say interesting. This is a first, a positive comment about AmeriCable. So I feel
like I had to read that twice.
Yeah. So, okay. Here we were having issues playing our Netflix. And oh, by the way, thank you to the region for getting the IP addresses unlocked.
Yes.
So now you can play your Netflix without a VPN. Also speeds things up. We're having trouble playing our Netflix. And I called them called the Netflix, and they said it wasn't them. So I called AmeriCable, and they troubleshot several different things. The long story short is they ended up going to the Netflix site, AmeriCable did, and figured out it was not AmeriCable. It was actually some settings with Netflix. And so they went above and beyond to help this customer.
Yes.
So that's good. So I felt an obligation to say that, you know, it's not like AmeriCable doesn't care. AmeriCable does have challenges, technical ones. But they have, you know, no one shows up at work saying, I want to screw up today. You know, that's my belief. Right? Sometimes people are lazy or something gets in the way or they'd rather be on their iPhone instead of working. But if no one shows up at work saying, I want to screw up today. And so I feel an obligation to let you know there are good people out there and they are doing the right thing. And, you know, my experience with AmeriCable has never been with a customer service problem. It has been sometimes with the technical side of things. There you go. Okay, what's this one for? Let's see, I kind of switched it. This is the galley, the jewel of the East dining facility.
Yeah, yes, sir. This is the allowing retirees.
Yeah. So, as a veteran at 20 years of naval service, it is unfathomable to be prohibited from using a Navy military dining facility. And it goes on. And I don't mean to be pejorative or to minimize this thing. Thank you for your service. You are no longer on active duty. And we don't make up the money. It costs us more to feed people than we charge.
Yes.
And so the galley is for sailors. I mean, CNIC, Commander Naval Installations Command, has this galley to feed the sailors who are assigned here. And so since we are in a fiscally constrained environment and will be for the foreseeable future, now that we're $17 trillion in debt, we were making decisions fiscally based. So it is not a reward or entitlement to have to be able to go to the galley overseas forever. Regret that you're inconvenienced, but we do allow folks to come on special special days, one day a month. Thanksgiving and Christmas are open days. And we tend to have our celebratory days. Like this was Martin Luther King celebration.
Yes, just had one.
Coincident with our open galley. And people are allowed to come one day a month. I know that, but yeah, this is not a service that is paid for by Veterans Affairs. It is paid for by Naval Installations Command and the shoreside budget, and is for sailors. And that's why the decision was made some time ago that this is for active duty. And that's that is the reason. There's nothing about respect or disrespect or anything. That's it. That's what it's there for. And in years past, we have been had some flexibility, and we don't have any flexibility. We certainly don't have any flexibility. When I say we, I mean the United States Navy. I certainly do not have the flexibility to make a policy open door to all these things. So there you go. Because it cost the government, cost the Navy money to feed people. And so if they're going to spend money, they're going to spend it on active duty Navy. So not always satisfying, but the answer is the answer. Okay, let's go down to Pizza Hut. On Yokosuka Naval Base is supposed to begin taking orders for delivery at 1630. And I have had success ordering at 1630. As explained on their automated voice answer machine several different times in the last quarter or so. Attempts were made to delivery. During the attempts, each instance consisting of anywhere between 5 and 10 individual phone calls. Okay, so you're calling a lot and bad things are happening. Phone would ring and there would be an answer followed by an immediate hang up on the phone. So is the answer a voice or is the answer just a pickup? My experience, because that has happened to me, is it's a pickup and a hang up. And I can tell you, as I mentioned last month, sometimes I will just go down there and hang out there and try and be incognito, but you know, I get made very early when I'm down there. I like to hear what's going on in Grand Theft Auto 5 and what the latest profanity is out there that I may not be accustomed to. So I'll Google the Urban Dictionary to figure out what today's sailors are talking about while I wait for my pizza. But no, I'm just kidding. Actually, everyone's, you know, it's not, no, people don't do that. I'm just kidding around. But I will sometimes go down there or take the, you know, just take the kids down there, go out of the house and do that. And they are not picking up the phone and hanging up on you. I can tell you they are constantly cranking out these pizzas. And so there is an issue with their phone system, I think. So what their answer is, or what they've gone through is, yes, very long question, very long answer. So they've taken a lot of steps to ensure the phone system operates correctly, and they went to the BCO, or the Base Communications Office, and having them do operational checks for the incoming and outgoing phone calls and the line quality and all those things. And it looks like they didn't find anything wrong with the system, but they did say, and this one I've kind of taken on board, if you call from a cordless phone or from a mobile phone, if there's a particular drop in the quality or a drop in the signal, that can trip you offline. So I have taken to using my landline, and I will say that I have not had a problem, because that also my landline in my house, it's like my answering machine slash thing, I go on speakerphone and listen to the fascinating, you know, music or stories that are going while they're waiting for my order. So I would try that. But it is, they are very, very busy because they're the only ones with cheese in the crust. I don't know why they're busy, but they are busy.
Yes.
And they're right by the waterfront too, right? So sailors, you know, will call in and then go pick up their pizza. It's very convenient. Duty nights and stuff. I used to do that when I was down on
that oven.
Blue Ridge used to be down when I was here. Blue Ridge was on Pier 7. Yeah, it's right there.
Yeah, that was when we were dredging 12.
And Kitty Hawk was on 8 and 9.
Yes.
That's why. Yeah. We're old. Anyway, if you didn't pick that up, but anyway, you were saying.
These
ovens are on there.
They are always going. You will see literally, actually, people going there, especially a lot of folks that are duty on the ships. You know, they'll be going down there, you know, while you're trying to call. These guys are going down there and picking up 10 pizzas to go for their duty section. So nobody at Pizza Hut's deliberately dropping you on your phone.
You ever see those toasters in some kind of like buffet thing where you just put your bread in and it rolls and off the cliff, it comes out toasted. That's what their pizza oven is like. They are putting those things in, and they are coming out, and they're boxing them and shipping them. So,
and it's quick. But it is those quick. Guys, they're working, and I've called down there just like Captain has, and sometimes you can be on hold for 10 to 20 minutes because we're talking a population of, 22,000. Some people are ordering pies from their workplace to take home to a Kega. So, it's a busy place down there.
Yeah, I do wish they had an online system, but that would just require them to have an online person checking these things too. Anyway, I regret your inconvenience, but I would give that. It's probably not going to improve your wait time too much, but for drop calls, try and use a line that is hardwired into the system and see if that improves anything, like BCO recommends. Communications office. The fleet fitness center is talking about the increasingly unsatisfied with the odor coming from the weight room, and needs to be cleaned or at least ventilated more frequently. And this one, the smell's coming from the floor mats. Now having, thank you, 5 minutes, getting the high sign. Congratulations, everyone. You only got 5 minutes of me left. You're almost on my side on this thing. What are you doing? But the thing is, it comes from the floor mats, which I understand. The mats are kind of spongy and sometimes absorbs that stuff. I used to wrestle in high school, and the only thing worse than when the mats got kind of funky was the day when we would disinfect the mats, because of course we're the ones who had to do that, and then they just it was bad too. But yes, we're going to replace all those mats, and that's a big part of it.
It is, and it takes a little while too, because remember that we're not going off base and buying these products that we replace over at the gyms. We're ordering them from the states. And you do have transit time to get that equipment and floor mats and things like that over here. So it's not like we have a warehouse readily stocked with this here in Yokosuka either. So.
Yeah. Okay, here one. Here's one from for Taco Bell. The Pepsi always tastes like root beer.
I like root beer.
No, that's kind of odd.
I hate Pepsi.
I'm not a big fan of fountain soda. It has like to me, it tastes kind of soapy or something. The ratio. It's the ratio of soda to. It is a lot cheaper though, for them. Not cheaper for you, but it's a lot cheaper for them. The Pepsi always tastes like root beer. No other food service I'm faced has this problem, so I brought it to their attention. And so here's the answer. It is the next maintenance team. And the manager's on site, and they had the lines purged, cleaned, and rinsed with nothing but clean running water, and they taste the product afterwards, and everything was fine. You can tell a quality pub in Ireland, right, if you go
flushing
there,
the lines.
Do they flush the lines at night? If you don't, no matter what it is, it tends to build up on the lines, and it taints all the flavor. So you do have to flush the lines all the time. And so there you go. So hopefully that was the answer in this one. Because it does. I understand. I don't know how it tastes like root beer, but I do understand that if you don't flush the lines, it is a problem there. So hopefully that this is, hopefully you can go back to Taco Bell and check it out. I'm in the United States Air Force. Procedures are different for gate entry sponsoring for local nationals and vehicle ID. They were here a few months ago, and there are three petty officers that did a great job, professional, patient, very friendly, and they made their visit more enjoyable. Just not the visit was so enjoyable I had to go through the gate, but clearly front line of customer service is right there on the main gate. If you come in and you're all ticked off because you had a bad experience, it's going to ruin your day. So, the bases are different. U.S. Force of Japan says thou shalt have an access program, and it leaves it up to the services installations to do it. So I understand that. Let's see. Moving on here. Some of these were personal ones. We'll let them go. Bowling alley, daughter's sixth birthday at the bowling center on 10 January. And want to comment, the party was a huge success, and thanks to the Bowling Center and Mr. Jimmy Ken Rogers.
They have a great party plan.
They do. That's actually birthdays. Pretty good. I haven't done a birthday party there this time around, but years ago I have done one. I've been there several times for large groups. Very accommodating. I just wish they'd let me use the bumpers.
I see a lot of commands doing wardroom or chief's mess hall and farewells at the bowling alley. A lot too. It's a great deal.
It is.
A lot of fun.
It's a little louder though for hail and farewell type thing, so I've kind of waved off on those because you do want to have a little bit of ceremony in one part of that, but it is great to just kind of kick back, relax, and get your frustrations out, knocking down some pins. So, but thank you very much. So birthday parties, they do them in the pool as well if you're looking for options. Put the Whibbits out there and have all kinds of very
cold
tailored.
Well, not today. It's not cold, but It's a little cold for the pool today.
Pool today, but you know, party gym.
I wonder how many people did the polar plunge.
I don't know.
We missed the stats.
I didn't see the medical assists in the desk journal of, you know, a bunch of, you know, Bugs Bunny like ice cube people floating up. So I guess it went okay. But there you go. And also paintball. Can't have paintball without pain. I'll tell you what. It's
yes.
The headshots are particularly yes. I took my my son out for paintball on his birthday and I lost. So to them. But no, it's good. So paintball's another good one too. You gotta be a little bit older for that one. That's a fun one. The pool. There's people are looking for things to do for birthdays, and that's one. So okay, so here's one kind of interesting one. So there was an employee of Fleet and Family who, as a joke, put onto this Yokosuka resale, hey, I got all these free coupons for sale, kind of stuff. And so there's a comment on here. I doubt the next provides the Fleet and Family with coupons to sell for the base personnel. It seems like an abuse. And so you were followed up too, because of course the director of Fleet and Family takes this stuff seriously and went back and said, no, it was a private Facebook page. But this is my comment, it's not about this. This was a joke, and it kind of got out there. Social media is really wanting to bring this up. So this is on a private Facebook page, and it gets forwarded, and people think it's a serious thing. Yep. So you have several obligations. One, if you're going to post things, there is no such thing as deleting off the internet. I don't know if everyone knows that. I mean, I kind of know it because my background is in IT and computer science, and I guess I have a lot of backgrounds when you're my age. But when you put it out there, you may delete something which you think is deleted. All you've done is delete a marker that points to it. There's no taking off, right? In fact, those servers are still out there. The information is accessible, and someone's going to find it. So if you're worried, and if you don't think that people look you up when they hire you for a job, you are mistaken. So be careful what you post. There's no such thing. We used to say this when I first came in. There was a message that we send, you know, command to command. There's a version called the Personal 4. It would go like from Personal 4, commanding officer, and go right to them. It's just a message that gets routed. And so if you were to route that to the Admiral staff higher up, they would give a copy of all the personal fours to all the different people. So this was many, many years ago. But there's no such thing as personal anything, okay? So be very careful about what you post. And also, if you're reading things, read with a careful eye. Maybe it is a joke. Maybe it's in bad taste. Maybe it shouldn't be there. But if you're on a private page, that's a pretty good indication that maybe it's not meant for general consumption. So let's see. Here's one about the road paints, parking lines, and those things. We do have a plan. It's a, we'll call a phased plan to go and replace all those. Asking for MWR has way too many Facebook pages. Send this out via email to families. Again, back to my push versus pull. We're not going to push all these email things to you. If you want something, you can pull it down. We're going to keep using Facebook and WordPress, and because we save $90,000 a year by not printing this stuff, 90,000, which we can now use to, you know, pay for somewhere jerseys else. Or somewhere else. Yokosuka Benny Decker Theater. Can we have bigger tubs of popcorn for drinks, kid packs, and nachos like Sasebo? What would Mrs. Obama say if she saw this comment? Well, I don't know what she's going to say, but the response is, we're working with all Navy bases to standardize our theater, and we're going to have bigger popcorn sizes. So there you go. So much for the MWR Health and Fitness working with the MWR Theater operation. But there you go. So, yes. So, but the comment is, hey, in Sasebo we have this size, and here in Yokosuka you have something different. So, again, there will be standardization, and the people have spoken. The people will have more popcorn. Okay, my last comment here. There was a comment in here about why is there no breakfast during the week. We're going to try and find some breakfast options here for you. There's money to be made. Say it out loud. Say it proud.
Super Bowl.
Yeah. Super Bowl, this is not going to be my last comment, but the Super Bowl is U.S. Forces Japan has declared a training day for Super Bowl Monday for us. The theaters are open, Fleet Theater's open.
Yes.
Concessions clubs. Will be open, the clubs will be open, and that is Monday the 1st. February 2nd, Groundhog Day. So if you come out and don't see your shadow, go to the Super Bowl anyway. And so that's going to be a big one all over base. A lot of commands are obviously supporting that. We have an official day off. You know, I go in on days off because that's my happy place. There's no one else working to stuff my inbox with stuff I got to sign. Right. I signed my name about 30 times before lunch. Yeah. you know. But anyway, Super Bowl, make some plans for it. Go out with your friends. Go to one of these things we have on base. Should be a good time. And they do get kind of fun, kind of rowdy. People wear sport jerseys, this, you know, and it should be good there. So thank you very much for that to our public affairs, doing their job here, public affairs, pushing that word out there. February 2nd, at the clubs, at the theaters, we have a whole lot of stuff going on. So get the word out there and go as a group, go as a command, do your thing. This last one, my last comment is, Dear Chapel of Hope / CFA, CFA will be me. Could someone please explain why the chapel is losing our full-time Catholic priest? I will explain that to you. The new priest to replace Father Caraba will not be here till July. True statement. And you were shocked to hear he was leaving. And it's a shame there's so few priests that he's leaving because, you know. I said something about foolish bureaucratic practices. That's what we call the United States Navy detailing process, or I'm not sure what you mean by foolish bureaucratic practices. Here is really the answer. Why is he leaving? Because it's time to go. And I think he's actually going down to South America is where I think he's going to be going with the not Franciscans. Sure. Yeah, he's moving on. He says he's going to go down there and learn some Spanish first. You could do that in Chula Vista. He's going to be in San Diego, down where I used to live down there, and that's good. So he's going to move on and do other things on behalf of the Roman Catholic Church. There are less than 50 Roman Catholic priests in the United States Navy, chaplains. There are very few Catholic priests, not very few. There's a shortage of Catholic priests in the Catholic Church. So the chaplains allow, their faith group allows you to become a chaplain. You can't just do it. You can't say, I'm joining the military. You have to request permission. And they have it's a very limited time they open that valve and let that happen. We were discussing the break. The reason why the Catholic chaplains tend to be older is because the Catholic Church wants them to have had like their first 20 years, or in some cases, before they allow them to become a chaplain. And so you got less than 50 chaplains. There are 70 naval installations like this one. Not all the same size, but like this one. There are 280-plus ships and the entire United States Marine Corps. Because, as you know, the Marines do not have chaplains or corpsmen. They are Navy. And so we have to service all those folks. So where are the Catholic priests going? They are going where they are most needed. So I think the comment that you're probably going to receive here from Chaplain Smith, the head of the chapel, you know, the folks who are downrange in combat, watching their friends, get injured, themselves get injured, go in harm's way, PTSD, all these other things, they are a priority to get out there and service them for their spiritual needs, emotional needs, and all of that stuff. And that is where they are going because that's where they're needed. So I said, I think it said in the thing there, don't begrudge someone else having a priest because we don't, you know, pray for those people that have a priest. Because that's, you know, they need them. We're going to get a priest in July. We're committed to the capability. We're not committed to having a single person. We're not going to say, oh, that is the right guy for this job or this position. We try and have a capability. So it happens before. I've seen that one of the best ballistic missile defense guys in the Navy retire. And he was, you know, turned down to apply for higher tenure and everything else because it's time to go. So, but we'll have either contracted priests or priests from the fleet, right? Because there are some in the fleet, and when they're here, we'll do that. So we are committed to ensuring that we have a continuity of capability. It's all about the capability. I've spoken personally with Rear Admiral Kibben, who is the chief of chaplains, and she understands my concerns. I think I've made a very good argument of why, if anywhere, we need one here. And so we are going to take care of that. But as to why someone comes and goes, you know, regret that you kind of surprised. I think Father Karab has known about it for a long time.
Yes, he has.
Yeah, has known it for a long time. So, chose to share it in his own time, and his own time happened to be, I think, the week before he left. So, that's that. But so we are committed to the capability, and we are committed to making sure that we have that capability here. You know, a lot of sailors at sea. You know, I saw it when I was young too. It is a difficult, sometimes it's difficult for them the first time that they can't go to Mass or can't go to services because there's no priest on board. Now, of course, they get a dispensation from the archdiocese of the military, so they don't have to because they can't. But it's tough for some people when they can't do that. So we're kind of making sure we have the capability, and that's what's important, and we're committed to doing that. So hopefully that satisfies your immediate question as to really the underlying question, what are we doing about having a Catholic priest? That's the answer for that. As to why everything else left, well, it is a big bureaucracy and things change. So with that, I will say enjoy the Super Bowl. Go out to Ecago for the joint use ceremony on the 31st. Maybe participate in the fun run. And stay safe out there. Be safe on your bicycles. Don't go across crosswalks. And we'll see you around the base.